security. I've worked in technology, financial services, healthcare, multiple verticals. So I have experience in a lot of different verticals, plus small companies and large companies. And this is basically the recurring themes that I've seen happening across those verticals and across those different size companies. And I really like memes. And if you don't believe how much I like memes, I think you'll believe me after my presentation. And if you need more verification, find Ed McCabe. He will validate this for me. So what I want to talk about today is how did this presentation come to be? Why did I think this was something that was important to talk about? The recurring themes that I keep seeing. And then kind of a little summary of what I want you to take away from this presentation. And then I have a really fun video for us to watch. I think you'll find it funny. I hope you do. So first, why? You know, across organizations, I have seen the same things over and over, the same mistakes. And you know, you go to these conferences and you hear a lot of people talking about the same things over and over. Sure, the themes, you know, evolve a little bit year to year, but we keep hearing the same kinds of pain points over and over. And when you go out to these networking events or you're out with your buddies and you're exchanging war stories, it's like a one-upman's game of, you know, who has the most horror story, but they all kind of have these similar themes about them. And they'll be over, you know, spans of years that you keep, it's like, oh, well, at my first job, you know, this, this, and this. And then 3 years later or three companies later, I was, you know, somewhere else in a different vertical or a different size company. And wouldn't you know it, it's similar things happening there. And over the course of my career, sure, it's evolved a little bit, but you keep seeing kind of the same things happening over and over again. So the themes that I'm going to talk about is playing the right-wrong game, securing at all costs, reliance on tools, reliance on policy, eating our own young within the industry, and skipping the basics. So it's like it's Groundhog Day over and over again. You just keep hearing the same things. So first, the right-wrong game. So it's not about being right. And I know as security professionals, we are passionate, right? We love nothing more than to get into, you know, a heated debate or to sell our point strongly. And the problem is we get into these, well, I'm right, they're wrong, and you kind of dig your heels in, and then you've lost your audience, and you've lost the people that are backing you up, right? So it's like arguing on the internet. Have any of you ever read the comments under articles? And, you know, people start trolling, and then people start arguing, and it ends up being something like this. So we don't want to play the right-wrong game. We know we're right, right, people? But we're not going to get a trophy at the end of the day. We're not going to get a medal because we were the rightest. At the end of the day, it's about doing what's right for your business. And so you need to come up with a way to educate your business and get them bought in. And that means using language that the business understands. Get away from the techno jargon whenever you can. Learn about your business. Raise that business acumen. I don't know if any of you saw my presentation last year on Dreamer. If not, it was recorded. It's out there. Dreamer, D-R-E-A-M-R, Jessica Hebenstreit. You can find it. But it really goes back to that getting education about your business, raising your business acumen, finding out what those critical business processes are, and securing those. And I'll talk about this on the next slide, not securing just to the nth degree where it makes it impossible for anybody to get anything done, but the right level of security so that it's a balanced approach where the risk and the security are in stasis. So inform the business about the risk, get rid of the techno jargon. It's not about being right, so please stop it. So next is secure at all costs. I don't see this as much as I used to, but I still see it a little bit. And I see it more from those of us that have been in the industry a long time. When I first started in security back in the 2000s, It was, I am security, I am right, hear me roar, and I'm gonna kill you with my security. We are gonna be secure whether it's the last thing I do or not. And it was the wrong thing to do. We put in these ridiculous controls that made it impossible for people to do their jobs. We had these horrible policies that were very punitive. And all it did was cause contention with those that we are trying to support. And it didn't allow for, again, balancing that risk and having that right balance. And so what I really want you to take away from this is we really need to ensure that we have that business acumen again, right? It's not secure at all costs. And at the end of the day, as much as we hate it, it's not our decision to make. If we have explained the risk to the business, we've explained how we can mitigate that risk or reduce it, and the business at the appropriate level, I'm not talking, you know, Joe middle manager over here, I'm talking, you know, CFO, CEO, CIO, those kinds of folks, CRO, say, you know what, thank you very much, I understand what you've told me, but we're making the business decision to move on this course. And as much as it may just grate us, we have to accept that, and we have to help them move down that course in the most secure way possible. So next is Save Us Tool 1 Kenobi. So first of all, sorry for crossing the meme streams here, but how many of you have been in a situation where either you are looking for a new opportunity or someone in your network has gotten a new opportunity and they're like, oh, they have all the tools. They have 4 SIMs, they have 3 anti-malware, they have, you know, every endpoint visibility product, you know, possible. You know, it's a little hyperbole, but you get the idea. It's like, oh, they have all of these tools. And then the honeymoon period wears off and they're not able to do security any better than anyone else. Or you go out into these vendor things at these conferences, right? And the vendor's like, hi, you buy my product? I got you. You will be so secure, you're gonna be out of a job. You will not believe how, you know, my tool is the best tool ever, right? It doesn't work like that. Yes, tools are great. Whether you're buying commercial or you're using some open source stuff, there's great open source tools out there for those that don't have the budgets. But what needs to happen more is you need to invest in your people. If you're not investing in your people, and I'm not saying you have to send them to a $5,000 conference all the time, right? But you need to give them the time to do research. You need to give them the time to attend webinars, to do networking events, and continue to build them up as professionals. This is a rapidly changing environment, and we need to support those in our teams so that they can do the right things and be at the front of the herd, right? So tools are great, but you gotta invest in your people. You also gotta have some policies and procedures. How many of you have ever worked on a team? Again, you have all these cool tools, no one knows how to use them very well, or maybe you're using about 10% of the capability of the tool, and then the engineering team is like, oh, well, you know what? We have this other tool, it's really cool, we're gonna bring it in, it's gonna do all of this great stuff for us. And you take a step back, you have 3 tools deployed already that does that, but you're not using it to its full capability, right? Know your tools, use them to the best of their capability, but also have the policies and procedures to back that up. That being said, policy's not gonna save you either, right? How many of you have policies deployed at your organization? They've been approved, they've gone through the GRC group, it's fabulous policy. It's not enforced. No one knows about it. No one's been trained on it. It hasn't been published. People can't find them. If you have policies out there that are not enforced, or people can't find them, or they don't know they exist, it turns out you actually don't have a policy. And I find this over and over again, where people will say, well, we have a policy. Oh, that's great. When was the last time that was enforced? When was the last time that there were actually consequences to not following that policy? And how many of you have worked for a company or currently work for a company where part of their acceptable use policy is limited you know, words along the lines of limited personal use on the internet, right? Yeah, during your lunch break or whatever. Yeah, it's okay if you gotta do a little personal business. Come on, we know that people are online all day. They have Facebook up in the corner. Maybe they have Pandora running, you know, streaming some music, you know, using up all that network bandwidth. You probably have something in your acceptable use policy that says limited personal use. Those are not business cases, but you know what? It's not being enforced. And it's probably a poor example because, I mean, really, yeah, I mean, you can get some viruses and stuff through Facebook, whatever. Maybe, you know, a little data is leaking out because people are posting things they shouldn't be. But at the end of the day, it's not doing a ton of harm, right? But that's the kind of example where if you're not enforcing it, why do you even have it? Why are you wasting the ink and the paper and the bits and bytes to even have that written down? Lastly, it must be supported from leadership. So that goes back to enforcing the policy, right? And I'm not talking just about, you know, middle manager, director level. If someone violates the policy and they fight back on it and it gets escalated and it gets escalated up to a VP or maybe even the CIO level or the CRO level, you need them bought in on the policy and you need them to back you up on enforcing that policy. It starts from the tone at the top. And I think you've heard that at quite a few of the talks this week, is getting that buy-in from the top and that tone from the top. Someone was talking yesterday, I think it was Frank Abagnale, he was talking about if your CEO isn't wearing their badge, but you have a policy that says everyone must wear their badge. Why do you have that policy? The CEO himself or herself is not following the policy and sets that tone. The CEO is not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. My boss doesn't wear her badge. I'm going to wear mine. So you really need that buy-in from leadership, and you need them to back you up when you are enforcing the policies, which you should be doing. So this one, I feel very strongly about. I think that we are not very good stewards of bringing people along into the InfoSec career. We have a massive shortage of professionals in our career, in our chosen profession, and we tend to get caught up in the drama. I don't know how many of you are on Twitter and see, you know, we have these people that have been in the industry for years and they're brilliant people, but they like to troll the new people. They like to make them feel bad. And I'm not saying that, you know, we need to coddle all these people or that kind of thing, but we do need to be more open and welcoming to people that want to be in this industry and help us do wonderful things in securing our environments. There is a massive shortage of talent right now, and we need to be doing the things at the high school and college level to get people more involved. There's one group of people in particular that I think we are particularly hard on as an industry, and that is women. I saw an article yesterday or the day before that in our industry there are about 11% women. Now, looking around this room, I can tell you we have a lot more than 11% represented here, and I think that is phenomenal, but I would like to see that in any conference I go to. Any team that I join to choose to work for, I want to see this going up, and I think that we really need to be supporting women and not tearing them down. I'm part of groups that talk about this kind of thing, and the stories that you hear about how women are treated in this industry are appalling, and it needs to stop. And so if you're not an ally or you are letting your unconscious bias affect the way that you're treating your female colleagues, I encourage you to try and be more cognizant about that and keep that top of mind so that you're not coloring their experience and preventing women from coming into the industry to start with, or pushing them out because they just don't want to put up with the BS. So this is a fun one, skipping the basics. So How many of you have these brilliant people on your teams that you work with or work for you, and they're like, oh, we could do this and we could do that, or your technology team is pushing you to do, you know, this latest greatest thing that they saw in a magazine or this cool webinar they went to or the latest conference, but yet you don't have a software and hardware inventory. You don't have a robust patching process that you do on a regular basis for both applications and OS. You don't have hardening guidelines. I mean, basically, you've skipped the first 5 to 10 steps of the critical controls, right? I think we can all agree that those are kind of the basics that we all strive to have down before we're going to push the envelope and be extremely innovative. I would argue that that's great if you can do this awesome DNS hunting and filtering, and you have a badass hunting team, and you're doing really cool things with authentication and all of that kind of stuff. Fantastic. Bravo. I don't really care because you don't know what assets you have on your network, and so I don't think that those are doing you a lick of good, to be honest, because if you don't know what's on your network, you may think that you've done these awesome, you know, advanced secure things, and I'm going to tell you, you haven't, because you have assets hidden all over your network that you don't know about that don't have those controls and those awesome things on them. So it's like with sports, right? Get back to the basics. Baseball. Glove on the ground, right? So it's not going through your legs. Same thing here. Same thing here. Get back to basics. And I think that, we are an industry of very smart people, and we like hard problems. And, you know, building asset inventories, it sucks. It is boring. It is not super technical. It's counting and keeping track of counting. So get an intern or, you know, someone early in their career and teach them how to do it right from the beginning. But don't spend so much time on the shiny thing over here, because at the end of the day, it's not going to matter. It's not going to matter.
So from my perspective, a lot of the innovation is being pushed by the business side.
Absolutely. Yep.
Invisible to them, mm-hmm. and they don't understand, nor are they willing. I mean, you know, they're infrastructure type mm-hmm. things that they shouldn't have to worry about. Mm-hmm. How do you find that balance between that kind of thing? And I understand there has to be some strong IT management mm-hmm. involved in that, but still, we're there to serve the business.
Absolutely.
And if there's no time to do the basics, it kind of.
Yep, so I have two comments on that. So basically the question is, how do you convince the business to support these basic activities when they want to be innovative and cutting edge, right? So two things. One, our job is to educate. And I know that can be really hard. I mean, sometimes people just don't want to hear the message. And we need to make sure that we are communicating in a language that they can understand. I know I personally, even when I think that I've taken out the technobabble and that I've really brought it back down to the business, I know occasionally I'll get feedback about, wow, Jessica, man, that was super technical. You know, you can't talk to the business like that. They don't understand these things. And I'm thinking, what are you talking about? I took out all of the techno jargon. I brought it down to their level. But you know what? If they didn't receive the message and they didn't understand it, I didn't. And so it's my job to make sure that I am communicating in a way that they can understand. Secondly, I don't know, I think this will go over well here. Auditors are your friends. Get an audit finding that you don't have these things in place. And, you know, it's probably not going to be a low audit finding that the business is going to, okay, we accept that, whatever. You know, it's probably going to be more of a medium to high, where there at least has to be an action plan, right? A management response to it. And, you know, if the management response is like, okay, cool, thanks, yeah, we'll work on that over the next 15 years, you know, it might be better for you to find opportunity elsewhere. I know Columbus has a thriving community of security, and that y'all, not from here, so y'all, jump from company to company and all of those kinds of things. You know, find an environment that's going to be supportive and doing those kinds of things. You know, after you've given it the good college try. I'm not all for just jumping ship because I'm like, I can't do anything here, right? But, you know, if you're not making headway and you don't believe in the security program, then I encourage you to look at other opportunities because there's a lot out there. You know, like I said, we have a huge talent deficit right now. Okay, does that answer your question? Okay. So this is kind of a mishmash of other things that I see. You know, assuming compliance is enough. Hoo-hoo, I am PCI certified. I am never going to be totally pwned. Wrong. And as a matter of fact, in PCI, if you are totally pwned and you were compliant, you actually retroactively have your compliance revoked. And so, you know, just being compliant, and this is a big one, you know, the business will be like, well, we're compliant. We're following all the laws, we're all doing all this stuff. And yes, compliance is necessary, absolutely. But it's the bare minimum. Compliance is not enough. You can be in compliance with all the regs, all of the, you know, best standards, and you're not going to be secure. What you need to do is understand your business, understand their risk tolerance, and really get to that secure environment. The other thing is losing sight of the big picture. You know, sometimes we as an industry get really stuck on this little thing right here. And I find this sometimes maybe with security architecture folks or some of the engineering folks or even some of the operations folks that have worked for me in the past, where they're like, but they have to do this. It's going to bring, you know, it's going to be Armageddon if this is not done. Okay, yeah, take a step back. Let's take a breath here, people. You know, you need to look at the big picture. Yes, what you are doing is incredibly important. Incredibly important. The enterprise needs you. But at the end of the day, they have a business to run and they need to make money. And maybe this little thing over here isn't the thing you want to die on the hill on, right? You really need to step back and make sure that you have that big picture in mind. And I know it can be really hard because we get really focused in on things sometimes. And, you know, we care passionately about what we do. But again, it goes back to having that business savvy and understanding what you're doing. Proper risk classification. Now, this is a fun one because, you know, you're going around, you're filling out your risk inventory, counting your assets, counting your intellectual property out there, talking to the business units, and you're like, so, What risk classification would you put this at? How is this going to affect the business if this were to go away tomorrow and it's gone 3 days, a week, a month, you know, whatever your disaster recovery plan is? Oh, the business will come to a grounding halt without my widget. And inevitably, you are going to hear that from multiple business units. Oh, without this, man. We are not going to be able to function. This is where you need to push back a little bit. And you need to ask questions about, okay, well, walk me through. How does this work? What's the process flow? And you know what? A lot of times you're going to find that, yeah, it's pretty important to the business. And there could be an impact. You know, but a day, 3 days, a week. You know, there are things that we can do without in our business, and it will suck. I mean, don't get me wrong. It's not going to operate like it does today. But in those times where some of those assets go down or data were to go missing or unavailable, it's not like every single server is necessary and every single PC is absolutely necessary to the running of the business. And if you're working in a business where they can't lose one server without going out of business, you need to find a new job. Like It's just not the way it is. And so what you really need to do, this is where the education piece comes back in, right? And it doesn't have to be you having these conversations. It could be, you know, your next level manager, or getting the business units in a room together so that they can talk to each other and be like, oh, well, you know, Sally, actually, if that goes down, we have this process over here that can, you know, swoop in and blah, blah, blah. And that helps you get to what really is the risk. You know, what is the proper risk classification on these things? These are one of the hardest things that I find having to do as a security professional, is working with your businesses to find the true risk classification, because everybody thinks that their thing is the most important and most critical. So this last one is one of my favorites. Properly remediating systems. I am a big fan of image. It's like voting in Chicago, image often. Do it early and do it often. If you have malware on a system, blow that sucker from orbit. Just re-image it. People are gonna whine and cry that they have their pictures on there and they've lost this and they've lost that. You know what? Sorry about your bad luck. Your personal information shouldn't be on your work computer anyway, which, as I say that, I know I have personal information on my work computer. Secondly, anything that is that critical to your job should be backed up on a share somewhere anyway. And yeah, maybe a couple revisions older, but you know what? The risk of having improperly remediated malware on your system is a lot greater than, I'm sorry that you lost all your cat pictures. My fun video is more about this. I cannot stress enough, just re-image the systems already. I cannot tell you how many incidents that I have been a part of for incident response because a system was not properly remediated and the vulnerabilities were not closed. There were artifacts of the malware left that were allowed, reinfection. And you can't always get that persistence out because maybe you're not going to find it. You may not know everywhere, you know, every registry key that was changed and every file that was changed or dropped. So just re-image the system already. Jake Williams has a good talk out there online about this, about he and another gentleman riff on, you know, if the system's not re-imaged, about 5 to 7 different ways that they can reinfect the system easily. So the things that I really, really wanted you to take away from this talk is it's not about being right and wrong. And believe me, some of my favorite words to hear are, Jessica, you are right. I love it. But it's really not about doing the right-wrong game. Do what's right for your business. If you are not paying attention to your business, and I'm talking not necessarily even the vertical, although that's good knowledge and acumen to have, your enterprise that you work for today, what is important to them? What are the critical business processes? You need to be intimately aware of how your business works. And I know some of you are thinking, I'm a technical person. You know, I do programming, I do architecture, I do security operations. That's great, good for you. I do those things too. You need to know about your business or you're not doing right by your business. Balance risk and security. Again, we may not like that a business says, you know what, I'm gonna accept that risk. But if we've done our jobs of properly educating them and explaining to them the impacts and the consequences of accepting that risk, we've done our job. And it may suck, but we've done our job. Tools won't save you, but neither will policy. It's a balance, right? Have good tools, commercial or open source. Have good policies that have support from leadership and that are enforced, have good procedures to back those up, and invest in your people. Start with the basics. I can't stress this enough. Start with the basics. Know what's on your network from both a hardware and software perspective. Know where your ingress and egress points are. Know where you're hooking up to another business, via B2B. Support and grow our fledgling security professionals. There's a lot of opportunity out there right now where, you know, there's a lot of programs where you can get involved in the high schools, you can get involved in the colleges. Please do that. We, need the next generation to help fill these talent gaps that we're having. Get involved. And I know it can be time consuming, but it's going to be worth it. It's going to make all of our lives better and easier. Please, please, please get involved with the next generation. So now it's time for a fun video. Let's see if I can get this to work. And this is about properly remediating systems.
Es ist dem Fall gelungen, die Front in breiter Formation zu durchbrechen. Im Süden hat der Gegner Zossen genommen und stößt auf Stahnsdorf vor. Der Feind operiert jetzt am nördlichen Stadtrand zwischen Frohnau und Pankow. Und im Osten ist der Feind bis zur Linie Lichtenberg-Marsdorf-Karlshorst gelangt.
Mit dem Angriff Steigers wird das alles in Ordnung kommen.
Mein Führer, Steiner konnte nicht genügend Kräfte für einen Angriff massieren. Der Angriff Steiner ist nicht erfolgt.
Es bleiben im Raum Keitel, Jodl, Krebs und Butter.
So I hope you enjoyed that. A couple of my friends made that out of frustration from a event they were working on. So one last thing, getting back to the women in InfoSec. These are two really great programs that I encourage people to get involved in. There's the Equal Respect initiative. If any of you were out at RSA, you may have seen the Equal Respect pins and t-shirts that were going around. Last year was pins, I think t-shirts this year. There's a Facebook, an open Facebook group called the Equal Respect Initiative, and lots of good dialogue and sharing of information there on how we can better support women in the industry. And then finally, the Executive Women's Forum. If you are a woman in security, I strongly encourage you to investigate this group and be part of the national conference that takes place in October every year. If you are a leader, I strongly encourage you to support your female staff in being part of the EWF. They do great things with peer mentoring and conferences, and they have an executive, it's called the Leadership Journey. So it's on, like, executive coaching. It's a really fabulous organization to be involved in, and I've gotten a lot out of it over the last couple of years that I have been. So I strongly encourage you to check out both of these organizations and be a supporter of women in our industry. And with that, thank you. I'll take questions. Come on, someone has a question. All right, thank you, everyone.